Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's our Hollywood Studios year-by-year feature, MGM 1940. We'll be discussing Northwest Passage, directed by King Vidor, and Strange Cargo, directed by Frank Borzage. At the end of the cast, we'll be doing our Fear and Movie Going in Toronto segment. We'll be talking about the final Kenio Tanaka film from the retrospective that played at the TIFF Lightbox, and that was Love Under the Crucifix. So before we get into the films, Elise, let's take a look at Joel W. Findler's roster of MGM stars. As I guess everyone knows, and we've remarked quite often, MGM was the studio that prided itself on having more stars than there are in the heavens, so this will be a longer segment than our Universal discussions of the roster, of course. And as always, Findler has his idiosyncratic rating system. 3 stars means a major, major star for the studio. 2 stars, an important star. 1 star is just someone worthy of mention, according to Findler. And no stars would be probably someone that is worthy of mention later on, but didn't really do much for the studio during their tenure there. So we've got Wallace Beery, 2 stars. Clark Gable, 3 stars. Robert Young, 2 stars. Johnny Weissmuller, 1 star. Tarzan, of course. Myrna Loy, 2 stars. Janet McDonald, 3 stars. William Powell, 3 stars. Mickey Rooney, 2 stars. Robert Taylor, 3 stars. James Stewart, 2 stars. Eleanor Powell, 2 stars. Spencer Tracy, 3 stars. Judy Garland, 3 stars. Walter Pidgeon, 2 stars. Norma Shearer, 3 stars. Lana Turner, 2 stars. Joan Crawford, 3 stars. Greta Garbo, 3 stars. Greer Garson, 3 stars. And Robert Montgomery, 2 stars. So pretty much everyone that was leading these cast lists got mentioned there. We're going to get into Northwest Passage, and we're going to hear what John Douglas Eames had to say about the film in the MGM story. Northwest Passage was one of the few movies shot entirely in Technicolor during the 30s. So we're doing it in 1940, but apparently for Eames, it was completed right at the end of 39, and he listed it there. But 2 years earlier, Kenneth Roberts' bestseller went into production in July 1939 when the script was only half finished. When director King Vidor brought his company back from a 12-week Idaho location, he found that the book's second half was no nearer an approved screenplay, and that producer Hunt Stromberg had decided to call a halt to the whole thing. A little footage tying up loose ends was shot in December, and book one, Rogers Rangers, was added to the title. The story of finding the Northwest Passage through Canada was never filmed, but the preliminary campaign against marauding Indians made a robust demi-epic, well-reviewed and very profitable. Robert Young, Spencer Tracy, and Truman Bradley starred.
It's hard to understand why they didn't do a sequel.
It made a huge amount of money.
Yeah, apparently it did lose money, though, because it cost so much to make. Do you think that is what was prohibitive?
Could be, right? Vidor obviously pulled out all the stops to film this huge outdoor Technicolor epic that could not have been an easy thing to do in 1939.
So of course it ends up being, much like Last of the Mohicans, well, far less interesting in terms of historical politics than that movie, but also mostly just a visual action film?
Well, I think we're going to have to talk about that, because certainly this is not the Vidor film I want to think about when I talk about Vidor being my favorite director.
Well, for one thing, there's no women women in it, and that is, in his best films, how he prefers to function.
Quite often, yes. However, I think there is a lot to talk about here. There is a lot to chew on. It's still not a fun movie to watch, for a lot of reasons.
Well, it's certainly, at the surface level, it's very racist, and it's also really boring.
Well, try this on for size. As I was watching it, I really could not help thinking about the parallels to Starship Troopers.
That, I thought of that a couple of times, because this is much more, even by the standards of the time, there's no persuasive argument made at any point for the colonial project. It's just nakedly presented, and it's assumed that you're on board.
That's what I'm saying. I think the movie is making a point of showing American troops, or English troops, who are American-born for the most part, committing war atrocities.
Yeah, and here in the Wikipedia entry for the film, under the section Depiction of American Indians, Clive Denton's 1976 book, The Hollywood Professionals, Volume 5, is cited, and talking about this book specifically as being very, very bad in its portrayal of American Indians. And so the quote here is that it sits more than a trifle uneasily that Spencer Tracy and his submissive band attack and burn a sleeping Indian village. The tribe has massacred and outraged, in square brackets, innocent whites, we are told, but we have not seen them do anything wrong, and they are certainly not belligerent in their sleep. Perhaps I should not berate Vidor for the conventions of good guys and bad guys in adventure movies, but I am still somewhat bothered by Major Rogers, who, beneath Tracy's charm, is something of a bastard. So yeah, I was going to bring that up as a possibility, but often when I suggest things about movies from this era being secretly subversive in their depictions of racist violence, you poo-poo that.
Well, when you're talking about King Vidor,
So you're just being a Vidor apologist.
No, but I think you have to consider it, right? Vidor was, certainly at this part of his life, a long track record of adversarial relationship with American culture. Despite being, you know, one of the great apostles of transcendentalism and all kinds of other American Renaissance type ideas, there is no way that Vidor did not realize that if you don't show Indians committing atrocities and you show your American heroes doing all of the psychotic violence,
yeah,
that's going to impact your viewers in a certain way.
Well, the film was enormously popular, so maybe it impacted them in the way that they really liked it.
Well, possibly, but I don't see how. Nobody likes that. They like to feel like there's righteous wrath being visited upon.
Well, how do you explain the film's massive popularity then?
The book was popular and people went to see it, but maybe they wouldn't have gone to see the second one after they got to see what it was like. I have no idea. It is true as well that this movie is really highly regarded by critics, certainly at the time.
Yeah, that's true.
Calling it one of the best movies ever made for a long time, and the best adventure movie ever made. Be that as it may, whether they caught the subversive intent or not, and whether there was any subversive intent, the way it's put on the screen, I don't see how you can see it any other way.
It did occur to me as well, when I was doing the research after this, that, of course, Vidor made Duel in the Sun just a few years later,
right,
which obviously, because there's a white woman portraying a mixed race woman, it's not progressive by today's standards, but it's certainly sympathetic.
Yes.
In the portrayal of that character.
Oh, exactly. And Vidor made Hallelujah, which of course also has its retrograde elements, but at the time would have been seen as an incredibly progressive film to have an all-black cast performing in a musical in 1929, right? It does have a lot of stereotypes that don't stand up in any way and need to be criticized, but still, Vidor himself, I think, would have seen all of these things as part of a wholesale critique that he was offering in movie after movie. And the lineage between this film and Starship Troopers gets even more interesting. This is all me conjecturing, of course, but it's called Rogers Rangers, right? To me, it seems quite plausible that Robert Heinlein was thinking of this movie when he wrote Starship Troopers, and, you know, the main squadron we follow is called Reshek's Roughnecks.
Right.
Which become Rico's Roughnecks after Michael Ironside gets killed. Of course, Heinlein meant it as pure fascism that he approved of, as far as we know. But certainly that's not how it's depicted in Verhoeven's film. I'd love to ask Verhoeven if he's seen this movie.
There are certainly little fissures that, if you want to make this argument, you can point to right in the text of the film. The most obvious one being the member of the Rangers who carries an Indian head around with him for quite a while.
Well, yeah, he's gone completely
mental. I'd like to know
if
that's in the novel, the beginning, and talk about what happens in
who
this movie.
Who are our protagonists? protagonists, right? It's Robert Young, who is a Harvard dropout or someone who's been kicked out of Harvard for being anti-establishment, and his best pal from town, Walter Brennan, who has run afoul of the magistrates time and again and is always in the stocks. So these guys are not exactly pillars of the community. We get a nice vignette of Robert Young's family. They are very accepting, ultimately, of his desire to be an artist and basically take up an oppositional attitude towards the colonial authorities. It's just that when his betrothed sides with her family, and that's Ruth Hussey, he gets hammered and gets into so much trouble that he has to run away. So these are our protagonists, right? So they have no stake in colonial society, certainly. They are, when they think about it, they're at odds with it. They don't like any of the rich people that are running the colony. They don't like any of the arrangements that have been made. And Langdon Town explicitly says he wants to go west and paint the people he sees there. Obviously, he's going to objectify them, but he certainly does not have any kind of investment in a killing rampage, as far as we can see.
Although when Robert Rogers lays it out for him, how he's going to have to brutally kill Indians before they kill him if he wants to paint any, he literally says, well, that's just common sense.
And it probably is true, right? If you go out in the middle of nowhere and pick a fight with people who are armed, you are going to have to fire back or get killed. And of course, this whole movie is about a bunch of people going to Canada and starting all kinds of crazy violence.
The entire subject matter of the movie is violent revenge on this particular group of Indians who, we are told, have been raiding some of the New England villages. But, again, we are never shown this.
No, exactly.
We are only shown this revenge project. I kept waiting to see if this would be portrayed in some kind of overtly critical way, like The Searchers, but of course that's years later. Like, I don't think you could do anything overtly critical in 1940. Could you?
I don't know. I feel like this is more critical than The Searchers, as far as I'm concern. I mean, we are turning around on John Ford a little bit, but I think King Vidor is a far more searing critic of American politics than John Ford is.
But by overtly critical, I mean, we do get an ending that ostensibly completely celebrates this figure of Robert Rogers.
Or it talks about him as a person who will do what is needed to enforce the national prerogative or the colonial prerogative. That's what it says, basically. And it says the people who hung out with him and love him don't want to hang out with him anymore. And Walter Brennan is staying home to drink, and Robert Young is going across the ocean to be a famous artist in England.
Well, the actual Robert Rogers ran afoul of the American government.
Yes, I read that.
You read about that, right? When he was launching this Northwest Passage search, this expedition that's only talked about at the end of the movie, everything seems to be very mysterious as to what actually went down, but it ended up with him being accused of treason.
Right, and he fought with the British forces in the American Revolution, which I think I would have liked to see that as the sequel. Like Spencer Tracy fighting the Americans.
Right.
We don't get that. Did you also notice, I read a little bit on the real Robert Rogers, and he married Elizabeth Brown.
Oh, that was the
Ruth
real
Hussey.
The real Robert Rogers? Yeah, that is in the novel as well. I read the plot summary of the second book.
So Robert Young never actually marries her.
No, he marries someone else, a character who sounds very interesting. An illegitimate, impoverished woman who becomes a one-woman show playwright.
No, is it Isabel Jewell's character?
No. A completely new character.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I wish they had made the sequel, actually. Because we were done with probably the nastiest parts of the story. Although, who knows? I'm never going to read those books or that book.
Do you think we need to talk about what the Northwest Passage is at all?
Yeah, I think we do, because it's referenced in the title. It's such a big part of the rhetoric that gets thrown about at the end of the film as well. And of course, it has nothing to do with the events that are depicted here. But the Northwest Passage obviously was something sought for centuries, really, by European colonists trying to see if they could bypass the Americas entirely and get to Asia and not have to go all the way around through the Indian Ocean to get there.
And it didn't, until climate change, it didn't really work very well, even after they did find...
Well, no, because it was a ridiculously northerly route that was frozen over most of the time.
Yeah.
So you can't do it. It does seem like Rogers was part of the mix for trying to find the most effective way to get across the continent and pursue trade that way, right? But the people that really really succeeded in the late 18th century find a way to get to the Pacific. Filling in the whole continent, all the maps, all the surveying, that's really mostly done by Lewis and Clark, who are commissioned to do it by Jefferson in the first decade of the 19th century. And what they're trying to do, right, it's not, again, they've given up on finding an oceanic route. So what they want to do is really, really get it down, figure out where all the rivers are, and how do you use river power to do most of your transportation for you to get from ports on the Pacific all the way to the markets on the eastern seaboard. Of course, nobody ever finds a river that goes all the way across the continent. That would have been too much to ask for. Mm-hmm. But they do find a bunch of rivers, like the Columbia River, several others that are in the northwest. And, you know, once you get to the Missouri, then that takes you all the way to the Mississippi, and you can get down to New Orleans. And then you're home free. And, of course, this is a time when, if you can't transport by boat, it's really an onerous thing to do.
And we, of course, we saw a movie similarly glorifying the gift to civilization that is a trade route.
Suez.
Right, right, about the Suez Canal. So, I mean, that is the vision of colonialism advanced here.
Yeah, it is. And of course, that's the face they want to put on it. When you know it's Spencer Tracy going out there, you know there's a lot of wholesale murder and genocide that's going to go along in the bargain, and that's what he's there for.
So perhaps it's no mistake that I found Spencer Tracy absolutely charmless in this movie.
Well, it's a very interesting performance. I was kind of impressed by it. Again, you have to divorce it from what it's showing you, because this is a thoroughly monstrous enterprise they're engaged in, and I think the movie is fairly honest about that without hard selling it. It's leaving it there for you to see that this is basically an SS commander.
Yeah, and also what you see, what the movie portrays, is how extraordinarily hard this mission is on the men, and to what end. You know, everyone ends up dead, maimed, or with their mind gone, or a combination of these things by the end of the movie.
They're definitely all hanging by a thread by the end, and several of them are never going to recover. And he manages to keep them together. They're commandos.
You did read, of course, that Robert Rogers put together this group of men that then became...
In New Hampshire.
Yeah, yeah. That then became a wing of the army.
Yeah, and they got their green outfits so they can actually blend into the forest rather than standing out and making big targets. They're not so different from the people that we see in the other French and Indian War movies that we've seen, right? These are Americans who know the ways of battle in North America, and they're not exactly 100% aligned with the British government, even though they are doing their bidding and fighting on their behalf. This is our year of the French and Indian War and our year of Abraham Lincoln. There have been a lot of recurring historical subjects this year. This is the final war that sealed the fate of French colonial presence in North America. Rogers is certainly part of that. You know, the raid that we see, Lake St. Francis, that's not really a lake, right? It's a wider part of the St. Lawrence Seaway, and that's in Quebec. So they were fighting all around the areas that I grew up. Just a little bit later than the events depicted here, they would take Quebec City, and that would be the end. Did I mention this in our other discussions? I don't think so. You know, growing up in Quebec, you learned Quebec history. Remember when we went to the Mount Royal Observatory?
Yeah.
And we saw all those paintings in that giant chalet?
Those were... Weren't the paintings depicting Indians attacking settler villages? Or was it the opposite? I can't really remember.
Well, they were depicting a lot of stuff like that. Yeah, this is basically French propaganda about New France fighting the Indians. It's no different from any other European settler power. They depict all of it that way. The one thing that is distinctive about those giant paintings that are hung up on the wall in that chalet, history stops in 1760. Mm. And there's nothing else depicted because that's the end. The British take over in Quebec. As far as the people who put this together were concerned, there is no more history until Quebec is free again. So there was a lot of fighting in upstate New York and southern Quebec, all around Lake Champlain. Vidor really put his all into visualizing what this would have been like. Probably the most Vidorian aspect of this film, actually, if you look at how it fits in with the rest of his oeuvre. He's one of the great poets of the individual, certainly, in film history. But he's also, strangely paradoxical way, he's also one of the great visualizers of cooperation, human cooperation, with the aim of achieving something that seems impossible. In Our Daily Bread, you've got the socialist socialist commune diverting the river to water the crops. And that's such an amazing scene. Here you've got this human chain across the river, which is an astounding feat.
Sure.
Just in real life, an astounding feat. And the way it's shot is incredible. He allowed these set pieces to inspire him, I think, to do some pretty impressive technical work. You know, it's all in the service of a movie that is either the most disturbing film you've ever seen, or, I mean, I think it probably is either way, but if you want to see it as a movie that is trying to provoke that kind of thought in your mind, a rethinking or a recontextualization of all of these colonial adventures as fascist death squads ranging north into Quebec, you can, I think.
This doesn't seem to be a film that Vidor chose to do. It's something that MGM thought would be popular.
Oh, yeah. Well, clearly. And it was.
Yeah.
Probably he didn't choose it, but you can't say he half-assed it.
No, all I'm saying is that if there's any kind of subversive intent in the portrayal, then it's coming from the director alone.
Yeah.
Not from the material.
Yeah, surely not from the book, and certainly not from MGM.
Even if you do take the Starship Troopers reading, though, which you can do regardless of the director's intention.
Of course you can, yeah, and I'm going to.
Yeah, exactly. Starship Troopers is also a movie I find pretty boring to actually watch. Like, it's a great idea, but I don't, unlike other Verhoeven movies, I don't feel the need to revisit it, you know?
I don't know. I'm not an action movie person, but
exactly.
I find that it does pull you in to its sick revenge plot and then make you see how bad you are for siding with these people.
So let's talk about the actual revenge raid.
Yeah.
Or massacre, really.
It's a massacre.
It's not a raid. They need food, but they're not doing it for that sort of purpose.
It's
not
their objective.
Yeah.
To kill everyone in that town. It's not a strategic mission, right? It's a genocidal mission, explicitly.
Yeah.
Their idea is we have to kill everyone we can because otherwise they're going to come back and get us. That's what they say.
Yeah, and that is explicitly the logic of the French Indian War as portrayed in this film, that there's all these different factions and they basically all have to annihilate each other, and they're just making strategic allyships based on these objectives. They have to annihilate each other, or in the case of the British and the French, they have to conquer each other. Roger's Rangers come running into the village and set it on fire.
And it's all designed, right? It's not something that just develops. He plans it out with his lieutenants and they say, okay, you're waiting here. We're going to burn their tents. They're going to run out of their tents. You're going to shoot every single one of them, right?
Except our Indians, our allies who have white crosses on their backs. So, but I'm trying to picture this. As I watch the movie, I'm trying to picture, do you think they really, in the heat of the moment, are going to be able to tell which Indian is which?
Because they've set it up this way, obviously their allied Indians are going to stay totally out of the areas where they know the men are encamped as death squads.
Yes. Anyway, it seems to me that this invasion and setting of homes on fire is what you usually see or hear about the Indians
doing. Right. Well, we saw John Ford did it in Drums Along the Mohawk.
Right, right, in these movies. So that in itself starts raising questions about how Rogers Rangers are being portrayed.
Exactly. No, I mean, you can't see that and think, oh yeah, they did this by accident. It's just a weird quirk that you don't see any of the other stuff. You just see these guys acting like psychopaths.
Yeah, and then in the midst of that, we get our character who turns unmistakably into a psychopath, even within the text of the movie, right?
Yeah. Well, he's just an extreme case, but they're all psychopaths, what they're doing. They show him gleefully just stabbing, bayoneting people who are already dead. And
well, no, he's gone insane. So, like, the way you would make this part of the critical reading of the movie is that this whole colonial project has made him go insane.
Right, exactly.
He's, like, followed it to its logical conclusion, which is bloody-minded insanity.
That's right. And I think the movie does make it very easy to see the whole thing that way.
And in addition to this guy, we also get long before the searchers, we get the woman who has been abducted and quote-unquote gone native.
Yeah, Isabel Jewell.
I would have liked to see more of that character.
Me too. She's always great. She's the great cameo actress of the 1930s. She always has a memorable moment or two, and she never really stars in anything.
And it seems like romance was developing with her and Robert Young, and that would have been very interesting, but
that probably would have been where they were going to go if they had done part two, right? But of course all of it was cut short and we have no idea what the original plan was.
And I mean, I guess overtly, for the purposes of MGM and the audience, she's supposed to have been turned into a savage who is the opposite of the ideal American woman.
Yeah, except she's totally awesome and helps Robert Young limp along.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, except that we're talking about King Vidor, and of course he would love a female character like this.
Yeah.
Right? And then there's also the Indian boy, who I guess his parents have been killed, that presumably that's why he's wandering away with the white people.
Yeah, it seems like it. I mean, again, it was recut, and there were little problems here and there with how they put the movie together. We may have missed a scene where we actually find out who this guy is.
Hilariously, Spencer Tracy just decides to christen him Billy offhandedly and be like, hey, you're a white person now.
Yeah.
Of course, implicitly, you're a second-class white person who has to be assimilated to the dominant norms, right? But it's hilarious because 2 years later, in Woman of the Year, he's doing the same thing to the European kid, making him into an American kid.
Right. Chris.
Chris. In a, what is a very racist role, a deliberately racist comic role.
Yeah.
By George Stevens. Just good old wholesome American racism from Spencer Tracy there, contrasted with the sophisticated Katharine Hepburn character, the over-sophisticated Katharine Hepburn character. So I just noted that continuity there.
He just renames little boys left and right, taking their birthright away from them. Obviously, Spencer Tracy took this role because he could see the possibilities in it, right? Just as an acting tour de force, I think it is, right? He projects authority without ever raising his voice, ever.
Yeah.
And that incredible scene where they get to the fort and he realizes there's nobody there and he starts to cry and manages to collect himself before his rangers get into eye shot. It is really quite something.
Yeah, it's funny because he is ordering all of these atrocious things, and yet he is doing it in this caring, fatherly way.
Yeah, I think this movie really deserves to be discussed a lot more and really looked at, even though it's not fun to watch, that's for sure.
But yeah, I said I found him extremely charmless in the movie, and part of that is what the character is doing. And I guess part of it is how actually anti-charismatically he's playing it.
Like, well, yeah, he's not Hitlering it up, right? He's not giving rousing speeches. He is just giving very soft-spoken orders to do what must be done and commit genocide.
Yeah, and he just has this belief system, and he's not pushing really hard to sell it because it's just normal to him.
He's just like, well, we're all out here now. If we don't kill everyone, they're going to kill us. So whatever you thought before you got here, this is what we're doing. Quite fascinating. A very unsettling film. I did read as well, however, that the real Rogers, despite all of his activities in these colonial wars, wrote several books, and one of the leading characteristics of his books was his sympathetic portrayal of American Indians. Just not the ones he massacred, obviously.
Well, he gives that speech at the end about how we're going to encounter all of these new tribes.
That's right. And hopefully we'll keep some of them on our side.
But even in the terms of those speeches, it's a very sort of characteristic American rhetoric about, they're basically zoo animals, the tribes. They're just part of nature.
Right.
So there's this paradoxical sense of America as this great land because of its natural wonders, including the Indians, but also this sense that we're here to subdue and conquer nature, and we'll kill as much of it as necessary in order to establish our way of life here.
Yeah, they didn't see any contradiction between those two things at the time, but I think Vidor does make us see the problems and the chasm between those two ideas.
Well, yeah, as you say, at the end, I mean, we've seen all of these men fall apart in various ways. More than one of them go mad. And by the end, they don't end up seeming terribly heroic. They just end up seeming...
they're part of the machine.
Harrowed and destroyed by the project. Yeah, as you say, like, Robert Young is choosing not to go back out there after his experience.
That's right. He's gonna marry Ruth Hussey, which apparently doesn't happen in the books, because that's not what happened in reality. She marries Spencer Tracy. And Walter Brennan is like, well, I acquitted myself pretty well there, but I'm just going to be drunk for the rest of my life back in good old Portsmouth.
The voice of Shakespearean low comedy. Well, they were actually abducted into this in the movie.
Yeah, they're shanghaied.
Yeah.
By wonderful Spencer Tracy, who gets them drunk and just drags them off to a fort.
Yeah, just like the Indian that he needs.
That's right.
And he will, he wants Robert Young's cartography skills.
When he sees that, he's like, no, this guy's gonna have to join us for this mission.
So they're kind of like us, basically, because we're being shanghaied into this insanity that is Robert Rogers' way of life.
It's a really fascinating movie. I don't want to call it essential because it's a very triggering experience as well. So you can give it a wide berth. I would not question that decision, but if you're ready to look at some terrible stuff.
When I said that Last of the Mohicans was politically more interesting, I meant what is dramatized is more interesting to watch of the politics of the time, but...
I think this is so much more interesting,
but
this
film. But if you think of the fact that that relatively progressive film from the 1990s has that scene that we discussed at the time of the Indian villain carving out a heart of his defeated enemy, right? And we were questioning that as a portrayal. And then you see that in this film, it's the white man who's shown doing that.
Yep.
It's the white men who are shown doing all of the atrocities.
100% of the atrocities committed by white monsters in this film. Give it a watch. Now we turn our attention to Strange Cargo. Once again, we'll hear what John Douglas Eames has to say. Strange Cargo was Clark Gable's and Joan Crawford's 8th movie together, and in it they succumb to that old urge again. But most of the picture dealt with the perilous escape of a boatload of cutthroats from Devil's Island. Good crowd-drawing stuff. With Frank Borzage getting colorful character studies from the stars and Peter Lorre, Paul Lucas, Albert Dekker, J. Edward Bromberg, Eduardo Cinelli, John Arledge, Frederick Warlock, Bernard Nadell, and Victor Varconi. Ian Hunter's role as a Christ-like regenerating influence added a mystical overtone which didn't quite come off. Joseph Mankiewicz produced the Lawrence Hazard screenplay from Richard Sayles' novel Not Too Narrow, Not Too Deep. Well.
Well, well.
That's one point of view on the film.
So I have really come around on Borzage. I'm not to the point where I'm going to love everything he's ever done, like that Tulip Daughters movie you like so much.
Oh yes, that's great. Seven Sweethearts.
Even more than Vidor. Like, I pretty much like, well, I had reservations about So Red the Rose, but you've certainly introduced me to a lot of Vidor female protagonist movies that are very great, and of course I knew some already, like Stella Dallas, obviously, but I've really come around on Borzage. I'm like full enthusiasm.
Yeah, well, these are probably my two favorite directors at this point, in terms of American directors, along with Dieterle and Capra.
I was gonna say, where did Frank Capra go?
He's up there.
And this is one of the very best Borzages.
Certainly a movie only Frank Borzage could have made. And it kind of starts a new line of inquiry that will continue when he gets to Moonrise.
So we don't have an official podcast agreement on what to call him. I'm still calling him Borzage, and you've switched to Borzage.
Well, it is Borzage, as far as people were concerned at the time, anyway.
Borzage. I'll try to remember because I was taught differently by people who wouldn't know, but by film people.
I don't think I brought this up before, but my favorite old-time radio program, and I only discovered it a couple of years ago, but I've listened to every extant episode now, Information Please, which is a quiz program with Franklin P. Adams and John Kiernan and Oscar Levant as the main panelists, but with a lot of guests. Anyway, there was a question about a Frank Borzage movie, and they were all kind of kicking it around. How do we say this again? There was one person on the show that said, well, I've met him. It's Borzage.
All right. I guess if we're going to go by Information Please, that's what we'll do. I'll try to remember. But this is also very much an MGM movie in that it's certainly a star vehicle for Crawford and Gable, and it made a lot of box office.
MGM could accommodate a lot of different things within their star-focused approach. They did not generally allow incredible scope for the most individualistic auteur of the 20th century, but in our movies this week, I think we can see that they occasionally did.
Yeah, because this is a use of stars in a way that now you would have to go to an indie movie.
Yes.
Almost. I mean, some people are still making smaller movies within Hollywood that are idiosyncratic, like very established directors like Scorsese, but...
Well, no, even Scorsese is making movies. It's not the usual model.
Yeah, not now. Like 20 years ago, he was still making movies in Hollywood.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. Joan Crawford wears no makeup for most of this film.
That's nonsense. She certainly has makeup on. That's complete and utter nonsense. Faces don't look like that naturally.
I'm not sure. Anyway, that's what they said.
It's a lie.
Okay.
They're lying.
Okay. Well, she doesn't look like she normally does, let's say.
That's true. And Gable looks really rough at the beginning of this movie. So does Spencer Tracy by the end of Northwest Passage.
Yeah, when he's breaking down crying when he gets to the fort.
No vanity there. What I'm saying about this being a vehicle for them, and Borzage treating it that way, among other things, is that Gable has never been more Gable and Crawford has never been more Crawford.
In ways that only Borzage could have seen. Because there are no other performances from either of them that are anything like this.
I don't know about that. Like, Gable is doing an ultra macho guy who turns out to be very emotional. That's his standard role. And Crawford is playing an extraordinarily tough character who turns out to be very emotional. And that's kind of her standard role, too.
Yeah, but these performances are quite different from any other performances either of them has given. I agree that it's within the realm of possibility for each of them. But the speech Gable yells at the end as he triumphs over Christ after killing him, or just about killing him, there's nothing else like that in Gable's career.
No, the things that he's given to play here. I'm just saying
that
the personas...
Oh, yeah, the personae are perfectly in keeping with what they always do.
Yeah, and also their acting abilities. Like, they are stretched as actors in this way in other movies. But yeah, the actual material that they're playing is unique here, for sure.
And it really serves them well, and they do incredible work here, both of them.
Crawford's character, Julie, seems closer to being the center of consciousness to the movie. But then, at the end, Gable does get that all-important confrontation with Christ, the incarnate Christ, the reincarnate Christ. Let's talk about this weird movie. What's going down in this movie?
So it's a prison break movie.
Yeah.
That's a genre.
And the sort of harrowing physical struggle that they go through provides perhaps the only link between this and Northwest Passage as a movie.
So I guess that's what we were thinking when we put them together.
Maybe. So Gable is a thief and Crawford is a prostitute.
Yeah, and we're introduced to Gable first as he emerges from a month in solitary confinement. What an amazing star entrance.
Yeah, it's very strikingly shot. And
the whole movie is.
Of course, it looks gorgeous. It just freaking oozes atmosphere every shot. But yeah, so he initially, as he emerges from the darkness, looks like he might be a monstrous, frightening character, right? And then when he starts blinking in the sunlight, he suddenly seems vulnerable and you wonder if he's actually the victim here. And I guess that's all intentional.
Yeah, and we see he has this adversarial relationship with Greedo, who we don't know what to make of at the beginning. He seems like just your basic prison commandant jerk, but by the end of the film we see that he's more aligned with the cosmic forces that are governing this film than we might have thought at the beginning.
Well, that's problematic, of course.
We'll talk
about that when we get to the ending.
Gable is a very philosophical convict, right? I mean, he talks about how even if he had 3 more minutes left to serve, he would still try to break out again because he's a thief by nature, a profession, and if he can't steal money, he will steal freedom.
Yeah, it's a condemned man escapes, basically.
That's right.
It's Bresson.
Yeah.
Except this movie is much more interesting than that movie because it has way more sex in it. Like, this movie is so entertaining.
I don't know how anyone could resist it on any level, really. But I suppose there are people who might be put off by one aspect of it or another. So that's Gable. Basically, he's bent on escape no matter what the authorities do. And I guess you do get a hint of, you know, this is not a complete sadist, Greedo, because he's like, well, I don't know what else to do with you, so I'm going to give you more freedom than you used to have. I'm going to put you on the outside of the walls and see you like that.
He says the jungle will get you if you get out.
Yeah, but he's just saying, well, maybe you won't want to escape if you get to see some women occasionally or something. I don't know. He's just trying anything. He's like, I don't want to send you back to solitary, but we'll have to if you keep trying to escape. Let's see what happens. That's how he winds up with this job loading barges, and he spots Joan Crawford.
And they have quite a meet cute.
Yeah, it's basically a sexual assault.
Yeah, he is a rapist at this point. It's absolutely clear that that is his plan. He will...
Well, he grabs her by the ankle and threatens to break her leg off if she cries.
Yeah, he'll break her bones if she doesn't have sex with him.
And it's really viciously detailed on the screen. You can almost see the motion that it's just one further twist and her leg would come off.
Yep, what's...
It's very violent.
Yeah, and he's doing it all with his Clark Gable charming grin.
I'm not a cluck baby. Now twist your leg off.
Before this, we've seen her first encounter with Peter Lorre's character, Pig.
Yeah, Monsieur Pig, Cochon.
We don't ever fully learn why everyone, and especially her, are so disgusted with him.
No, we know. He's an informer.
Well, yeah.
Everyone hates an informer.
I guess. Within this hierarchy, that's always the lowest. And of course, the fact that he's played by Peter Lorre works as shorthand.
That's right.
Even if you don't understand that.
This is Peter Lorre, not in his matinee idol phase, where he got like a new hairdo and lost a little weight.
But he also got his teeth fixed at one point.
Right after this.
What year is Mad Love, though?
Well, Mad Love is much earlier.
Yeah, I find him very beautiful in Mad Love. I've always had a bit of a Peter Lorre crush, but it all depends on how he's photographed. And here he's just playing the creep, the slime ball, but he does that very well, of course.
He does everything well.
So the fact that this is Gable and Crawford, I mean, the fact that they've made all these movies together and they're such big stars for MGM.
This is their last one.
Really works toward giving us a subtext we need to this hyper-violent scene, right?
Yeah, we know they always love each other by the end.
Yeah, exactly. And specifically, we know that she is attracted to him, but she just doesn't want to be raped.
Yeah, it's reasonable.
And he has no intention of interacting with her in any other way. And of course, there's also the complication that she can't fraternize with him.
Right, if she's caught talking to him, even if she didn't initiate it, off the island she goes. And we're shown that there's no mercy on that score from the authorities.
So they have this awful, tense, but very sexually charged exchange, and then he tells her he's going to show up in her room that night.
Yeah, he makes a vow. We have no idea how he plans to actually keep this date that he has made unilaterally, because it seems like the authorities would frown on that. And we see that they have methods for keeping track of the prisoners, but this is where the mystical plot takes up, because he slips away, and normally they just catch him because they count. They have 36 prisoners in this part of the compound, and 36 men show up, and Gable's not one of them. The last straggler is Ian Hunter, looking very beatific, who says, oh, there's so much work to do out there. I must have just fallen behind. Sorry. And nothing more is said of it because they've got their count. So Gable gets a free hand for a while anyway.
We know that he has been kept away from women for a long time before he's been given this added freedom. So that's why he's as frisky as he is.
Yeah, he's pretty wild.
So he does show up in her room at this hotel/bar, and they have more of the same type of encounter.
There's a bit of a negotiation there. She makes it seem like it would be all the sweeter if he could actually win her heart without assault. He's like, all right, we'll try it your way, baby. And she slips out the door. She does not mean to betray him, though. She says, just get out of here before you're found here. But when all the soldiers show up, or whatever, the prison guards show up, she has no choice but to turn him in, because otherwise she's going to be blamed for the whole thing. And of course, they all showed up there because Peter Lorre informed. He's the only reason that happened. So they're called in to Greedo, the warden's office.
Well, he's always trying to get some kind of purchase on her. Right? So if he can get her in trouble, then he can get her out of trouble. Pig. I cannot emphasize enough how great all of these performers are in what they can do, because Lorre, his soft, pathetic persistence. He's like a rapist too, but he's just like this soft white rapist who's just never, ever, ever going to give up trying to put her in a compromising position so that he can own her.
Yeah.
No matter how often and bluntly she tells him that he's disgusting.
No.
He would literally be the last man on earth that she would hook up with in any way.
That's what she says. I'll never lower myself that far.
And Crawford has rarely been allowed to give as much sustained hardness as she does at the beginning of this movie.
Not since Rain, I would say. Which is an amazing movie, which we have in our schedule.
And I've talked before about the actresses of this era, the star performers of this era, and how women like that have never been seen on any screen again. Something happened after liberal feminism became the mainstream norm, and everything was about women's empowerment, and we're all going to pretend that we all really want women's empowerment, and you just got to get behind that, and every movie has to be about the empowered woman. You don't get psychos like Joan Crawford or Barbara Stanwyck as stars anymore, right? These women who... Those women actually grew up on the streets, and they are a little bit mentally ill, and they are... But more than that, because I'm sure you can still... There are plenty of mentally ill actresses still, but more than that, they are allowed to incorporate that into their persona, because the studios are just looking for the star quality. That's what they need, right? That's what they've decided is going to be their business model, the stars. And so these women, if they can bring audiences in, they can act this way, right? And then Betty Davis too, although from a very different background. And I don't know, it just blows my mind that any performer, particularly a woman, was ever allowed to behave on the screen the way that Joan Crawford does. Because she's not normal. But it makes perfect sense for this character.
Sure, she's been pushed around.
But you believe it. See, you just, it's not a performance. This is Joan Crawford being the essence of Joan Crawford.
Yeah, I think so too. I agree. And yeah, this is one of her absolute best roles. I think it's right up there with Rain and almost nothing else. Anyway, for this side of her character, she has other facets that come out in different ways in other films. But for pure harshness, you're not going to get...
And anger.
Right. And righteous anger. This is one of the top. She was taking more chances than ever before. Her career was starting to wane at MGM, right? They were getting a little sick of her. It did lead to a lot of interesting roles for her. You know, she plays the villain in The Women, which is not a film I like, a story I like, but Crawford role in it is pretty interesting. That's not something she would have done before getting into dire straits at her own studio. She does this movie. She does Susan and God, which is crazy as well. And then she does A Woman's Face in 1941.
But her persona is so extreme that it, even more than Barbara Stanwyck's, that every time she acts that way on screen, I feel like she's risking her stardom. You know what I mean? Like, it's just beyond.
Yeah, I agree.
It's just beyond what's necessary.
People are going to really see, this is an absolute unchecked psychopath on the screen.
But this is what she wants to do. This is what she believes her character is. This is how she wants to be, right?
And it did cost her ultimately, right? I mean, she loses her contract at MGM. They get rid of her and she goes to Warner Brothers and they can't find anything to do with her for 2 years. So
but
she does nothing.
Film noir saves her.
Film noir absolutely comes along at the right time for Joan Crawford. And Mildred Pierce is an amazing movie as well. So there's a whole other life awaiting Joan Crawford on the other side of the MGM Warner Brothers divide.
Now, Gable's character for most of the movie, you know, he's so good at this too. He does this in It Happened One Night. He can be the character, the male character, who does not have this developed inner life, does not have this developed consciousness, but gets it by the end of the movie. But he can spend most of the movie just being a little clueless. Like, the best example of that is Test Pilot, where the centers of consciousness are Myrna Loy and Spencer Tracy, the gay character, and Gable is just wandering around. He's actually clueless for the entirety of that movie, right? But usually he's clueless and then gets a clue by the end. And here, never more spectacularly than here, right?
Borzage was like, this is a key to Gable, and I'm going to give him the opportunity to really deliver a tour de force.
So here he's just, for the majority of the movie, a charmingly one-note...
Rogue.
Incidentally, more brutal, but once he realizes that he has feelings for Joan Crawford, less brutal and more just macho, basically.
And again, we've talked about this with Gable a little before, because we've done other movies with him. We should never forget that when Hollywood first got a hold of him, they were like, okay, this is a villain. And of course, we see that most spectacularly in Night Nurse, where he's Nick, the chauffeur.
And do you think as he becomes, as with so many of these great male stars from the studio era who then go on to be big box office for decades after, right, way longer than the women, who have the aging problem, and who also, I think they're the edgy personas that made them stars, did also make it difficult to sustain that stardom. So all of these male stars, on the other hand, become just comforting patriarchs, right? But I think probably they lose a lot of their more interesting qualities in the process of doing that.
Yeah, well, we'll have to see what you think as we go along, and we see Gable at other points in his career. He never fades as a star. He dies a couple of days after finishing filming The Misfits, so he dies in the saddle. I think he's amazing in The Misfits.
Yeah, he is, yeah.
It's a great, great film. And throughout the 50s, he does some very interesting work.
Yeah, I don't know. We're not going to solve that right now. I'm just throwing it out there. But certainly, just as Crawford has this extreme psychotic hardness and anger to her, he also has this villain edge that he retains even as he becomes romantically. And of course, in his very most most famous role in Gone with the Wind, he does threaten to murder his wife and then rape her.
Yeah, sure. And he's a rogue in that movie. He's a rogue about 50% of the time. But this is a much lower rung rogue. He's just sort of one of the big men on Devil's Island. And he's got one opponent who is pretty much as macho and as tall as he is, which is Albert Dekker, Maul.
Okay, let's talk about Maul and the kid.
Yeah.
So this seems every bit as open a portrayal of a homosexual relationship as we saw in Michael, in Dreyer's silent film in our last episode.
I would agree. I don't see how you could see it any other way.
I don't know how this was missed. How did this get by the censors and also the critics and everything else?
Well, I don't know how any of this movie was made, right? It seems blasphemous. Christ is a character.
The Catholics didn't like it.
No, of course they didn't.
The complaint was made. The Catholic Legion of Decency condemned it for presenting a naturalistic concept of religion contrary to the teachings of Christ. So I guess that means the fact that there's no intervention of the church. I don't know. Irreverent use of scripture and lustful complications.
I mean, Cambro explicitly says, you know, a cross is a piece of wood.
Right.
All these other things that are sacraments don't matter. It's like always with Borzage, it's a transcendentalist version of Christianity.
Yeah, and also the idea that God is in all of us, that's a no-no.
Exactly, exactly.
That's Gnosticism.
Or Quakerism, right? So
something nonconformist anyway.
Definitely, so the Legion of Decency. But again, I don't know, how did the Breen office allow it to pass? I guess they just said, well, nobody's going to see it because it's being condemned anyway, so it's fine.
Well, but they did see it.
I guess they did, yeah.
But this is near the end of Borzage's tenure, too.
You know, he's all over the place, right? He was not an MGM director for very long.
Yeah.
And in the 40s, he's going to be independent for a lot of the time. But he does stick around at MGM until 42, I think, because certainly Seven Sweethearts is also at MGM.
Yeah, so how this movie got made, we're not really sure.
Crawford is clearly a prostitute. There's a lot of talk about sexually assaulting her.
Clearly, yeah. So, yeah, and breaking her bones, and that's our romantic couple.
Yeah. We'll talk about all the characters, I think, because everything's quite interesting, but Hessler, Paul Lucas, not punished, escapes. The guy that is a murderer. Well, that, again, is not supposed to happen in a code film.
No, that's true. Right. I was just thinking about the theological implications of that, but yes, just in terms of the code, that's not supposed to happen.
You're always told that that can't happen.
Yeah.
There's punishment for every single criminal, but not Hessler.
How did he get away with this movie?
I don't know.
I don't understand. It was God. It was an act of God, clearly.
This is the new gospel.
Yeah, so back to Maul and the kids. So they are explicitly compared as a couple to our heroes, Clark Gable and Joan Crawford.
Yeah.
It's just the same.
He says he's like a kid brother, but we know what that means.
Yeah, I mean, and in Michael, he's like a son, but we know what's going on.
He watches enraptured as the kid sings a song.
He says at the moment when he sacrifices himself is that the kid might have missed me the way
that's right.
Julie would miss you.
Yeah.
So they are compared to the romantic couple.
Yeah. And Albert Dekker plays this character as a ruthless brute until that sequence where we finally see that he does have feelings.
Yeah, except in relation to the kid, he always shows his feelings.
Well, he does. However, he did let the kid go with the group of people that he didn't expect to make it through.
But by the time they're on the boat.
Yeah, that's right.
He's talking about the life they're going to have together later and confessing his feelings.
That's right. Let's string along together when we get to France.
So let's talk about some of these other characters who end up on the boat. Escaping.
So Eduardo Cinelli is Telez.
So Telez is the parody of religion.
Well, he's basically the Legion of Decency, right? We're just sticking to the dead forms of religion.
In order to save himself personally.
That's right. And not doing anything for anyone else.
So you would think in this movie's terms that he would end up being condemned by the movie, but of course none of them do.
No, nobody is bad, ultimately.
So he gets his epiphany about his selfishness before he dies. There's the paranoid.
Flaubert.
Who gets his epiphany about seeing everyone as an enemy instead of seeing them as potential friends.
Yeah.
Who gets eaten by a shark.
He does, but he's already had his salvation because at that point he's realized. And so he tries to do something for the group and he doesn't realize that the cask has been infiltrated by salt water and is no good anyway.
But as interested as Cambro is in all of these characters, well, let's say a little bit about Cambro. So very early on, first of all, he's materialized out of nowhere. into this.
Yeah, he appears when he's needed to be the 36th man back in the camp.
Right. So he has a bit of dialogue there with Hesler.
Paul Lucas.
Who is this wife murderer, but who recognizes him as a good debate partner, Cambro, right? They could have intelligent conversation about philosophical topics, about the fate of man and morality and life and all of that sort of thing.
And Paul Lucas is your Nietzschean for the film.
Yeah.
Clark Gable calls him Superman.
A few people suggest that he's the devil. So he's basically a nihilist.
Yes.
He represents a nihilist position, but he's interested in having that challenged.
Yeah, he's in an adversarial role to some extent with Cambro, but they also are very congenial as they discuss.
Well, obviously he's a sort of Flannery O'Connor nihilist in that he has considered Cambro's position and rejected it. He's considered the proposition that life has meaning and rejected it. Yeah. So he's still interested in that possibility.
And he's the one that says, we have to take seriously that this is Christ or some kind of supernatural force, because he's right about everything that's happening.
Well, you know, of course, in the Bible, I think it's in the Gospel of Mark, that the demons recognize Christ. They're the only ones who do.
Exactly. And that is what Hesler is ultimately, right? And that's what he says when he leaves at the end. We're skipping around in the film, but I think that's fine, right? Everyone else has had their moment of epiphany and come to God, come to themselves, come to the God in themselves, except for Hesler. And he says, you have to lose once in a while or else the triumphs would be meaningless. And of course, that's part of what the devil is all about. The devil is a narrative construct in order to inject some stakes into the drama of salvation.
Really, more than any film noir, this movie bears the most comparison probably with the poetic realism Carnet and Prévert.
Right. Well, this movie, and later, maybe even more so, is, you know, Moonrise.
Yeah.
Moonrise, the ultimate soft-boiled noir is what I always call that genre, and it's very much in the poetic realist tradition, for sure.
So yeah, so Cambro is there not to save lives or to stop evil. He's just there to save souls. He's just there to make the people who have the potential to do so come to Jesus.
In doing so, we get a kind of theodicy, right? We get a justification for suffering. It's ordained as a way for people to make decisions, act in a selfless manner, and realize that there is something greater than the self, and that is where you find God when you make that decision. Every step of the way, that's what Cambro is looking for. And so, yes.
Well, I mean, that's like the Keatsian idea of the world is a veil of soul making.
Right, exactly.
We could challenge that viewpoint, but we don't need to get into that.
Of course we should challenge it if we're talking metaphysics.
It doesn't actually ultimately make a lot of sense. Why would the world be designed this way?
No, it's monstrous, right? But if you're looking at the world as it is, and you're trying to find some way to justify it all and have some meaning emerge from it, then this is the best way, probably.
Yeah, and then you have to ask yourself, so who is this Jesus in this world? Who is he? He's a god of very limited power. He's more like a bodhisattva. Like, there must be many of these. And they just come to this hell world and try to intervene a little bit.
It's not Trinitarian Catholicism, clearly. He's not one with God. He is a minor divine figure who is just working within the parameters set up by the maniac who designed the universe.
Another Flannery O'Connor type idea, which is that you can find God in any man.
Yes.
Or woman. And it's very important, or woman, in this movie, because as usual with Borzage, the gender stuff is explicit and important. So Cambro is here to save all of these people if he can, but he's particularly interested in the romantic couple, and I think largely for Julie's sake. He's most interested, like the director, he's most interested in her.
Well, she's the one who's not a real criminal.
Right, she's the fallen woman, so therefore sympathetic.
Right, in social terms, she's a criminal, I guess, because she's probably violating some laws, but not laws that anyone would agree with, whereas everyone else is there because they're murderers or at least thieves. But I think it is quite important for the film's logic that Gable, it's explicitly stated he's a thief. He's not been sent there for killing people.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess what we end up with is that we have this romantic couple who are allowed to live and start a new life, and then we have the demonic figure who is incapable of being saved and gets to go back to his normal activities.
Yeah, again, without precedent that I can think of in the Code era. Nothing happens to him except that he has a moment of, he shivers as he leaves, right? And he's like, no, I won't go back to Jesus. That's it, though. And there's no... Usually you'd at least get some kind of coda, like, oh, well, the police caught up with him and killed him or something. No, nothing. He's at large.
So I find all these dynamics very interesting after Gable and Crawford show up on the beach. Basically, all the men are going to rape her. So Gable has to fight Mull, the leader, so that he can become the leader and protect her.
It's basic alpha male stuff.
And also, he has to become the leader just because otherwise Mull's going to kill him, too. Because that was the reason he got left behind in the first place. Mull was like, there can only be one leader.
Yeah, I'm the big strong guy in this group. Everyone else is a different character type, so they can all coexist with me. Cambro is like a wild card, and Gable just disrupts the whole dynamic if he comes along.
They fight, and Crawford is watching this, and Gable wins. And then for a while, they settle into this dynamic where he's the alpha male, and she's his mole. She's his girl, and he treats her that way. He's very macho, and she seems to enjoy that to a certain extent, find it sexy. Although she's still tough Crawford, like at a certain point he calls her the second toughest man on the boat or whatever. And so you think maybe the movie is asserting that now they've found their ideal form, which is that they're the two toughest characters, but the man is still in charge of the relationship, right? And the woman likes that.
But of course that's not where we end up at all.
That's not where we end up. That's not how things shake out, right? And of course you also get the idea that even if he lost the fight, she's still in love with him.
Yeah, she doesn't love him because he wins the fight. Of course not.
But she does get a very smug, that's my guy, expression on her face after he does.
Well, yeah, and also, pragmatically, it's a really good thing for her that Gable wins, because otherwise she'd have to fend off Maul and...
Yeah, she's not going to be capable of that. We also didn't talk about the moment when she hears the voice.
Well, yeah, I think we should talk about that mining camp guy, Mafur. What a creep that actor is. And I've seen him in other movies. I forget his name, but he really conveys absolute monstrousness.
Bernard Nettle. Yeah, so she chooses him over Pig.
Yeah, and that's a really nice moment for Peter Lorre, because he's like, you believe this guy? She's like, no, but I'm still going to go with him over you. And as a viewer, I'm like, no, stick with Peter Lorre. At least he's just going to whine at you.
Yeah, exactly. Like, we actually see at the end what happens once he has her in his power.
He wants to marry her.
And he won't touch her without permission.
Right.
So she's not going to get raped by Peter Lorre.
Yeah, but she just has so much disdain for him. She's going to throw in her lot with this psychopath from the mining camp.
Yeah, and then so she's getting, you know, raped by him. She decides she's going to kill him because he won't let her go.
But Cambro speaks from off camera, not that way, Julie.
Because to kill another person will condemn your soul.
Yeah.
And I mean, I guess that is the ultimate hardening of the self.
Well, we certainly see it in Roger's Rangers, don't we? You don't want to go that way. Cambro's right.
And then she gets, she doesn't get rescued by Clark Gable. He just interrupts the scenario.
Yeah, he just walks in. It's quite amazing, that whole scene, right? Because she's gonna kill him. She gets interrupted by God and then loses the upper hand again. And then it's gonna go back to all the old awfulness with Mafur, and Gable barges in and takes over the situation.
And of course, we know that she does like him.
Right, so when she does have an opportunity to choose between Vern, Gable, and Mafur, of course she throws a frying pan at Mafur. Otherwise, Gable would have gotten in big trouble there. He turned his back on this guy.
And then somehow the two of them have had enough interactions that Gable has gone out of rapey mode and is starting to like her and wanting to protect her.
Yeah, well, he's like, well, we got to get through all this craziness anyway. We'll put that on hold. And there are a lot of tense jungle scenes in here. We got all the usual, we got some quicksand, we've got crocodiles, we've got poisonous snakes.
And she's not used to this kind of rough living.
Well, yeah, she's got her high heels. She doesn't have any other footwear. Some pretty fun scenes there as they try to get through the muck.
Her toughness is not a physical toughness, in other words. It's a spiritual toughness.
No, but she never whines. She looks very worried, though. It's quite...
Every time she loses her hat, it is pretty funny.
I really like it, and it's quite an interesting acting choice.
He actually never... Like, the normal thing to do in a movie at this point is to tell the woman to leave her hat, but he never tells her to leave her hat.
No.
Although she eventually ends up without it, but...
No, it's true. I mean, he doesn't make any sarcastic remarks either. Like,
well, he looks at her in a very frustrated way, but...
Yeah, but he keeps his mouth shut.
I mean, it is probably good to protect yourself from the UV.
Oh, well, yeah. Especially once they get to that beach. There's no more canopy.
Yeah, but there's also, at that point, no more hat and no more makeup.
Yeah. Oh, you agree there's no makeup by that point?
She's wearing no makeup makeup, Dave.
Okay.
That's what it's called.
It's certainly deglamorized.
I wouldn't say that. But by the standards of the time, I guess, for Joan Crawford.
Right, which is taking a chance,
but her
right?
eyebrows are pencil thin, and her face is a white mask, so she's still pretty glamorous. She never looks less than star quality gorgeous. She just has pale lipstick on. That's the only difference.
Well, yeah, but that is a big difference, you know, for audiences at the time. They would certainly not have expected to see her looking that way.
No, I don't think anyone is supposed to look that way unless they're in a death scene.
Right.
So I guess we just need to deal with, we've talked about everything except the ending, the resolution between them.
Right. And the impasse that they reach there is that Gable thinks that they've succeeded with their prison break and they just have to push on to another part of the world where they can live it up and he can pursue his criminal enterprises as he always has. She wants a more stable life, one that does not land them in trouble with the authorities. Seems reasonable.
And the way Gable plays this is very interesting because you can tell that Vern is just talking. It's just like a whole, it's just a bunch of talk, right? He it's not that he sincerely wants to continue to live this way. It's just his patter, and he's too afraid to offer anything else.
But by the movie's logic, the reason that things can't go ahead this way is that Gable hasn't made any real sacrifices, has not thought of another person. Just deciding to live a wholesome life with Joan Crawford, even that wouldn't really be a major sacrifice.
Well, he has thought of another person. And he has acted to protect her, but in this...
No, you have to do something much more than that.
Yeah, but also in this very macho way, like he owns her.
Exactly.
Come over here, baby. His little shtick about plant a kiss here with her, that she repeats that back to him when he's leaving.
Plant one right here, and he says, now it'll keep till later.
Yeah, but I mean, this is Borzage trying to establish an equivalence between the genders that Gable can't allow himself
right.
to do.
The logic of empathy and suffering has to have this further turn of the screw. The narrative has to bring the pig back and force Joan Crawford into bondage to Peter Lorre, basically, unless Gable rethinks his whole life plan and accepts serving out the rest of his prison term.
And she's pretty much accepted that Cambro is Christ at this point. So she will just take his word for it that not only will her action save Gable's life, it will also save his soul.
Now, Gable resists this to the last possible moment, and he wants to allow himself to believe that Crawford has betrayed him, even though he figures it all out for himself. And then Cambro says, well, doesn't that make the most sense? He's like, well, I don't care. I'm still fucking off to Cuba.
Well, she has her moment when Peter Lorre first makes his proposition to her. She does have her moment of saying, go on, go on, go and get him, go and take him back, before she realizes she can't go through with that.
Yeah.
So she also reverts to her former character briefly.
And then they get ready to take this voyage to Cuba in one of the craziest storms ever put on film, I think. And Gable is just barking orders like it's a normal pleasure cruise.
Right, and then he's so angry that Crawford has left him that he just, and also he knows what's expected of him at this point. He does understand that a conversion is expected.
Yeah, well, he's seen everybody else succumb to it, right?
So, and he's really, really, really going to resist that. So he just decides, even though it's not in his nature to be a murderer, he just decides he's going to resist this by killing Cambro.
Well, Cambro dares him to do it, right? He's like, go ahead. What's stopping you?
Yeah, he goes out onto the deck to make it easier.
He just smiles at him, and Gable's finally had enough and knocks him into the water. The fisherman, Victor Varconi, we've seen him before. You recall him? He plays the French doctor that we saw in Disputed Passage, also kind of a witness to all kinds of spiritual restoration or transformation.
Again, the spiritual dynamics in this are so, other than the fact that this movie is way softer than any Flannery O'Connor story, they're so similar to Flannery O'Connor. The sort of theological background, it makes me wonder what this pulp novel by Richard Sale is.
Not interested in any way in reading the Northwest Passage novel, but I am interested in reading this novel.
Because I'm like, the basic story is very interesting if it's in the novel. It's not just the treatment of the material, as fine as that is, right?
Yeah.
And one of the things that makes the movie so great is that it feels like a pulp story. That's what makes it so damned entertaining. That plus the great stars, the great character actors, you know.
And Borzage's 100% conviction, right? This is not Hollywood fake piety. This is a real religious zealot, Frank Borzage.
Yeah, but what kind of religious zealot?
Special, transcendental religious zealot.
Not any kind of particular brand of Christian religion that you would, you know, organize religion.
No, no.
We've talked about it before. He was a Mason, but then, like, everybody was a Mason. This is not a Masonic religion that we're looking at here.
No, he tells stories about souls in jeopardy, right? I mean, that's what he does. And he's not doing that to please crowds. He's doing that because he is compelled to do it. This is his great subject.
There's Gable's whole big speech after he's thrown Cambro overboard.
And he talks himself out of his Ubermensch mode as he yells at the heavens.
Well, I mean,
he's like Captain Ahab.
The problem is not that he thinks he's a god. Maybe that's Hessler's problem. His problem is not that. The problem is that he can't believe that, because that's what he ends up...
But then he does, right? He realizes, wait a minute, there is a spark of the divine in me.
Well, first of all, he's saying, this is ridiculous, the idea that I'm a god.
I'm a god on holiday.
And then he's saying that, yes, I am a god. I am the only important thing in existence.
Well, at that moment he is, because he's the only one that can save Cambro. And just step by step, as he gives this no-in-thunder speech, he says yes.
He says a god, I'm a god, and you're a god. And then once he says that, recognizes...
That they're both splinters of the divine, and they have to work together to make something good happen out of all of this craziness.
And this is the climax of more than one Flannery O'Connor story, so... But never quite in this way.
No, I doubt it, but...
She usually, you know, has a serial killer on hand or something. It's, like, more intense, but...
So Gable brings Cambro back and thinks... And you could be forgiven for thinking, well, if this is Christ, then maybe he has been crucified. We've seen him floating in the water as if his arms are out, stretched between nails.
I mean, the speech really shouldn't work under those cheesy circumstances.
It's incredible, though. I don't know, it works on me every time.
Oh, no, I was crying.
Yeah. So you might think Borzage's going to go the whole way and Christ is now dead. And I guess he kind of is, right? But he's resurrected. It doesn't take 3 days. He comes back. And then, of course, Gable just pulls out all the stops and just starts crying and hugs him in a way that you don't see very much.
No, but I mean, that is a part of the Gable persona.
Yeah, he can do this stuff.
And we've talked before, more than once, about every time some critic brings up that Gable didn't want to cry at the end of a movie or something because it would interfere with his manly persona. He cries at the end of a lot of movies.
Yeah, I don't know if it's ever quite like this, though. This is another unique twist on the Gable emotionalism, but it's always there.
Oh, no, he has a total breakdown after his child dies in Gone with the Wind.
And of course, the next step is he's going to have to go back to Devil's Island, not because he really deserves to. That's not the angle the movie is taking. It's that he's got to make this sacrifice, serve out the rest of his time to free Joan Crawford from bondage to Peter Lorre. And Greedo, the prison warden, is totally all for this. And is like, I knew it. I knew you'd come back. We made you a better person. Me and Cambro and Frank Borzage.
Yeah, that's odd. It's just odd having the prison be aligned with this cosmic plan.
The worldview espoused here is that we are all trapped in a charnel house prison and we're trying to help each other as best we can.
I mean, I guess.
That's the universe. And it certainly seems like it sometimes, to me even. But is there any benevolent force behind it? That's the part I don't believe.
Are there kindly wardens?
No, I would say that 100% there aren't.
There's not, but this movie doesn't present a benevolent force behind things. There's the mystic assertion at a certain point, which is in the Bible, that all is right now, all is well now.
Once you've made that turn, yeah, because then nothing can affect you, because you are in sync with the forces that are beyond our ken, right, that are outside of the physical world.
Yeah, so you have to imagine that means...
It's a Gnostic vision.
That means that in the vastness of the cosmos, all is well.
Right, exactly.
We just can't see that in our tiny little corner of it.
Yeah, and of course that's a leap of faith I've never taken.
But it is a consistent mystical experience, like an intuitive emotional experience of everything being implausibly and paradoxically right. Of course, obviously this is what David Lynch talks about in his transcendental meditation. It's not just a Christian mystic experience.
Yeah, but for Borzage, again, it's always tied to what people can do for each other here. That has to be a component of it. It's not just, oh well, now I am in sync with God because the spirit has touched me. It's, I've done something, or I've made a decision, I've changed the way I think about my fellow human beings, and now I am in sync with God.
I was looking at this Kent Jones essay on Frank Borzage. I didn't read the whole thing, it's quite long, from a 1997 issue of Film Comment. I'll put it on the Discord. It's very interesting in a lot of ways, but I also disagreed with a lot of the things that he has to say about Borzage's films. One of the things I disagreed with a bit was his assertion, because everyone talks about love as Borzage's big theme, his assertion that one reason Borzage hasn't been rediscovered, doesn't fit with the postmodern moment, is because of the absolute metaphysical certainty that love provides in his movies. But I would want to challenge that a little bit, because if you think of something like, well, even this movie, where love isn't providing metaphysical certainty for anybody but Joan Crawford until the end, but also Little Man, What Now, where the male protagonist nearly despairs, despite the fact that he does have this love that is the only thing that is keeping him from despairing, right? I don't think it's as simple as this writer is portraying it.
Now, there's always a social component. You know, there's a component that goes beyond the bounds of just the two people involved in a romantic relationship in Borzage. It's about finding someone and falling in love. Certainly, most of his films are about that. But it's about what that then enables you to rethink about your relationship to everyone else as well.
Yeah, and I mean, you can certainly see that in a huge way in The Mortal Storm, right? Where these people, the romantic couple, fall in love, and that allows them to be
anti-Nazis,
to be heroic and to stand apart from this whole society that is collapsing in hate.
But it's not automatic. You also have to do more work after you fall in love, right? And that's certainly what Little Man, What Now is all about. They're in love before we even meet them.
Yeah.
But their love has to go through a bunch of things before it matures to the point where they can work together in a way that is going to save them or pull them out of the crisis that they are in. And a lot of it just depends on other people that they manage to make connections with as a couple and separately.
Well, yeah, the whole point of Little Man, What Now is that this couple could not survive without random acts of kindness from people they encounter.
Oh, there's so much to be said about Borzage. I mean, this is one of his great triumphs, but there are many others, and they're not all the same. There are many modes and many moods to Borzage, and we'll see all of them before we're done, I think. If we have anything to say about it, we're certainly going to wind up seeing just about every Borzage movie, and I've never yet seen one that didn't satisfy in some way or other.
I also wasn't crazy that among the bad actors in Borzage's movies that hampered them, he lists Douglas Montgomery.
Oh, ridiculous.
So wrong. So, so very wrong. And also John Howard, who was great in Disputed Passage.
Yeah, I thought so too. Well, this doesn't sound like a very good article.
No,
but
no, no. There's a lot of interest in it, but some of it seems dated and needs to be surpassed. Well, you know, it's one of those, let's revive a director that doesn't have much reputation, so I'm going to be so, 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 so cautious in praising his films, at least for the first half of my essay, right? I'm going to list all the things that I think are bad or cheesy.
Well, if he's saying that Douglas Montgomery and John Howard are not household names today, and that works against those films.
No, mediocre to bad actors.
Okay, well, that's just wrong.
At least, it's certainly, and Douglas Montgomery has given more than one great performance, so he's a weird actor, but he's
very one of the greatest actors of the first half of the 30s, I think.
He's very, very good. So that would be Little Man, What Now we're still talking about.
So Strange Cargo, definitely seek this one out. No reason not to see it. Unlike Northwest Passage, which there are arguments against it, but on the whole, I think this was a pretty big time pairing. And all that's left is Fear and Movie Going in Toronto, Elise. So we have not discussed Love Under the Crucifix. How did you feel about it?
So this was I cannot pronounce this word. Jidageki film, which means period drama. Most often set during the Edo period of Japanese history from 1603 to 1868.
Right. The Shogun period, yeah.
I felt more bored by this one than I had by any of the others, because I don't think this is a genre that would interest me intrinsically, for most of the length of the movie. But by the end, what it had done, I understood what it was doing, and it felt very formally compact and assured. I was actually quite moved by the ending.
Me too. It's my least favorite, for sure, of the six. Andrea Picard definitely did not seem to agree. She thought this is a much superior film to The Wandering Princess. I don't see that. I think The Wandering Princess is really underrated. Even the people pushing Tanaka seem to be negging it. But this was a terrific film as well. There were no duds out of the six. Last time out, we compared the film to Life of Uhuru. This is not set in the same period, but it did seem to me to be tackling some of the same themes that we get in Sancho the Bailiff.
Oh, and really? I never thought of that for a
moment. It doesn't compare very well to Sancho the Bailiff, but really nothing does.
Yeah, practically nothing does. No, both the visual complexity and thematic complexity of that movie are unusual in cinematic history.
Yeah.
But by the end, I really appreciated how actually minimalistic this was in its storytelling elements and visual elements that seemed to be purposeful by the end.
Very moving film. The camera work is remarkable at points.
It's not taking that extraordinarily broad philosophical worldview of Sancho the Bailiff at all.
No.
It's much more focused on what love is doing for the female character, for the protagonist. And I thought it was fascinating, the appropriation of Christianity for this purpose by the ending. And the movie's open hostility to Christianity and its juxtaposition. Well, insofar as there is a philosophical worldview in the movie, it's this juxtaposition of Christianity and the tea ceremony.
Sure, the tea ceremony is definitely presented as a much more coherent and reasonable philosophy of life.
And when we do the movies, when we actually do her as a director subject, we can talk about what that means.
Version of Christianity we get is, you know, it's not a Borzagian version of Christianity, right? It's more of a Telez version where Christianity is just Madonna whore stuff.
Hatred of the carnal.
Yeah.
Yeah, not interesting.
Not something you want to embrace.
I thought you were going to reference The Crucified Lovers.
Well, there's that too, right? Of course.
Which is also
A better movie.
A better movie, yeah.
Yeah, well,
but this is still a very good movie.
Just by comparing it to some of the greatest films ever made, it might fall by the wayside a little bit. And it's a little sad that we ended on this one, because some of the other films in the sequence do stand up against those masterpieces, right? Yeah. They are all-time great films as well. This one, I think, is just a really, really good film. It does have a great performance at its center by Iñigo Arima, who we know, actually, at least, because she is one of the stars of Equinox Flower, the Ozu film, which we haven't done on the podcast yet, but we will. And she also plays the more tragic sister in Tokyo Twilight.
Yeah, I really love her performance in that.
Big Christian Martyr is the guy from Human Condition.
Right. This is kind of a thankless role. This is a John Bowles role.
A little bit, yeah. I think you're right. A great performance, actually, from this tea ceremony master.
Yeah, the adoptive father of our main character.
Genjiro Nakamura.
Who plays the repulsive dad in The End of Summer, the Ozu movie.
He's got some range.
Got some dad range there.
We'll have a lot more to say. Very in-depth talks coming in 2028.
I guess the only thing I'd want to add is that you and I started, I don't know, maybe you had done this before, but since I met you, I've been making more of a concerted effort, because we've also been going to lots of retrospectives and things together, more of a conscious effort to see more films by female directors, to really explore that. It was something that I resisted for a long time, because it was just felt like something I was expected to do as a woman.
So much easier to be a male feminist.
And I didn't want to, identity politics to get into my movie viewing. But the delightful thing has been to discover how interesting these famous historical female filmmakers are. Always interesting, and in some cases unmissable. I guess the most unmissable for me so far has been Chantal Ackerman, but there's no one that we've investigated to date that hasn't been worth that investigation. That hasn't been, and by that I just mean pleasurable and interesting to watch.
No, I certainly would agree. And it makes sense that if you manage to get a shot at directing under those kinds of conditions, you're probably a pretty talented person. So it's not a surprise that it's kind of 100% success rate, because if you're a mediocre talent as a director, as a woman, no one was going to give you a chance back then. Now, I guess probably You can get away with it. It's still harder.
It's still very, very hard. It's still a very, very small...
Yes, of course.
...percentage of well-known directors.
Oh, yeah. The balance has not tipped.
Not much.
No. All right. Next week, back to Gene Arthur, part two. So this is going to be an interesting one, Elise. We're going to be talking about The Whole Town's Talking. That's the John Ford film, which I've had reservations about in the past. Talked about it before, where it seems like John Ford is trying to do a Frank Capra film, and I don't think he has the right attitude for that, and he uses Gene Arthur in a strangely proto-Capra way that just doesn't quite work for me. It didn't the last time I saw it, which was about 25 years ago. We'll see if it's different this time, and we have been trying to be more fair to Ford than I ever have been before in my life, so...
And again, it helps that we're watching mostly his movies that aren't Westerns.
That's right. So there's that. That's going to be the big one, I imagine, but the other one I have not seen, which is Party Wire. I don't know what to say about it except tune in and find out what we think and let us know what you think if you watch these.
See you then.